Welcome to each one of you. One of the most hotly debated and controversial questions in the Christian faith over the centuries has been, can a Christian lose their salvation? Over the next few minutes, I want to briefly present to you the conclusion that I've come to personally regarding this question. But I also want to encourage each one of you to be like the noble Bereans in Acts 17:11, who received the word with eagerness, with sincerity, and then went back home and checked the scriptures to see if what they heard was true. Can a Christian lose their salvation? I firmly believe that scriptures teach that a genuine believer cannot lose their salvation. In John chapter 3, verse 3, Jesus is conversing with Nicodemus, and Jesus tells him, in order to enter the kingdom of God, he has to be born again. I find it difficult to believe that a person who's born again, born of the Spirit, can then later on become unborn. One of the terms that John uses in his gospel to describe salvation in Jesus is the term eternal life. Jesus, the Good Shepherd, in John 10:28 says, while referring to his sheep, that is genuine believers, I will give them eternal life, not temporary life, not conditional life, but eternal life. And to make it even more clearer, he says, they will never perish. No one can snatch them out of my hand. The Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he becomes a new creation. The old is gone. The old has passed away. Behold, the new is here. In one of the most doctrinally rich letters, the letter to the Romans, where Paul goes to great depths to explain, great lengths to explain what happens in the life of a believer when he or she is justified. In chapter 6 and verse 23, he says, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. Which acts as a great segue into my next point, which is salvation is a gift from God. You and me can do nothing to earn salvation. We can do nothing to gain salvation. Therefore, it must logically follow that we can do nothing to lose salvation. When somebody says that salvation can be lost, it's a comment, it's an observation about the giver of the gift. And the giver of the gift in this case is God. It's like saying, God, thank you for your gift of salvation. It's a little bit inadequate. It's a little bit defective. I might just lose it. And I really think that God knows what he's doing. We're told in scripture that when we place our faith in Christ, we're given his Spirit. The Holy Spirit comes to dwell on the inside of a believer. And that's why Ephesians 4:30 warns us not to grieve the Spirit by whom we are sealed until the day of redemption. So it's not like the Holy Spirit comes to dwell inside of a believer and then later on realizes the believer is going to lose his salvation, so the Holy Spirit leaves, goes around somewhere else, and then later on if the believer returns to the faith, will come back and reside in the believer. The verse is clear that we should not grieve the Spirit because we are marked, because we are sealed, because we are identified by him until the day of redemption. Somebody might ask, what about all those warning passages in scripture that seem to indicate that a believer can in fact fall away? I believe that the warning passages are the effective means by which God keeps his people to the end. In other words, they will always be effective. The warnings will always be effective in the life of a believer. And there's a great story for us to understand this concept. It's found in Acts chapter 27, where the apostle is traveling with a couple of sailors towards Rome, and they're caught in a massive storm, and everybody's really scared. And an angel of the Lord comes and assures Paul that nobody will perish, no one will lose their life. But a couple of days later, the panic increases, and some of the sailors make plans to leave the boat, and they get the lifeboats ready, and Paul observes this and he goes and tells the captain of the ship, if anyone leaves the ship, they will definitely lose their life. He gives them a very strong warning. He warns them not to leave the ship, and this is in spite of the fact that he's already been assured through a dream that nobody will lose their life. Likewise, the warning passages in scripture are the effective means by which God's promises come to pass, by which they come to fruition. They will always be effective in the life of a believer. Somebody might say, what about apostasy? What about people who once claimed to be a Christian? What about somebody who professed their faith in Christ and then later walks away from the faith? I think there are two scenarios here. One is the person who's temporarily backslidden. They might be a genuine believer, but then for a while they might stray away from God. They might walk away from Him. For instance, hypothetically speaking, if I was next to the Apostle Peter during the time he denied Christ, I would have probably concluded that he's lost his faith in Christ. I mean, this is a man who's walked and lived with Christ and seen all the mighty and wondrous deeds that Christ did. He was with God in the flesh, Jesus. And so I would say that he's definitely repudiated his faith when he denied Christ. But we all know that he later went on to repent, that he was broken over his sin, and goes on to become one of the strongest pillars of the early church and did some pretty revolutionary things and was eventually martyred for Christ. So that is one scenario. The other scenario would be somebody who professes their faith in Christ, maybe even who's part of a church, but who are never truly saved, people who never genuinely believed in God, who never genuinely received the gift of salvation. And a biblical example would be Judas Iscariot, one of the 12 disciples of Jesus, who went, walked around with them, who saw all the miracles. He was even the treasurer of the group. But then we all know that he later on goes on to betray Jesus. And Jesus says about Judas that he was the son of perdition, that he was doomed to destruction, and it would have been better if he was never born. So that's an example of somebody who was never truly saved. And a good verse to explain this would be 1 John 2:19, which says, they left us because they never belonged to us in the first place. Because if they belonged to us, if they were truly a part of us, that is the group of believers, then they would have remained with the group of believers. But because they left, they were never saved to begin with. So those are the two scenarios when we talk about apostasy. But I always wonder why God allows this confusion to exist. Why does He allow us to wrestle with these verses? Why do we end up with different interpretations? And I believe that God allows this because there should be a healthy tension between God's sovereignty and man's responsibility. There should be a healthy tension between God's saving work and man's responsibility to work out, not work for, but work out his salvation with fear and trembling. So I hope this was an encouragement to each one of you, and I'll see you in the next one.